The shell conduction model is an effective method for modeling thin shells in heat transfer without needing to create solid shell bodies. Hello, and welcome to my channel. This is Armin. In this video, you'll learn how to use the shell conduction model effectively in your simulations. Before we get started, I'd like to give you a brief explanation of how it works and why it's useful. Conduction happens when heat moves through a solid material due to a temperature difference. It can occur in all directions and depends on the material's thermal conductivity. On the other hand, convection involves heat transfer between a solid surface and a moving fluid, like air or water. It usually occurs in the normal direction and depends on the fluid's motion and temperature gradient. There are three common approaches for modeling heat transfer through walls. Solid modeling is the most accurate, but it increases cell count and computation time. Convection only assumes heat flows in the normal direction, which is simpler but often inaccurate. Shell conduction is ideal for thin walls. It allows heat to spread in all directions without modeling solid parts. It's a smart trade-off between accuracy and efficiency. The concept is clear. Now let's start the modeling process. I will start by double-clicking on fluid flow to add it to the project schematic. Next, I will right-click on the geometry cell and select Import Geometry to load it. Once the geometry is successfully imported, I will double-click on the geometry cell to open it for further modifications. This is the geometry I previously created, and now I want to extract the fluid volume from it. To do this, I will navigate to the Prepare tab and select Volume Extract. This operation requires selecting two end caps to define the enclosed fluid region. I will hold down the Control key and select these two faces. Additionally, it requires selecting a seed face to guide the extraction. I will choose one of the inner walls as the seed face and then click the green check mark to confirm. As you can see, the fluid volume has been successfully extracted. Now, I will press Escape to exit selection mode and then hide the volume to check the solid sheet thickness. Now, let's check the thickness of the walls. I will press X, choose the Z direction to view the cross section, and click Plan View for better visibility. To measure the plate thickness, I will go to the Measure tab, select Measure, and then click on this edge. As you can see, the thickness of the wall is 0.75 millimeters. This section appears slightly thicker. I will select these two lines to measure their thickness. These two plates have a thickness of 1.5 millimeters. Now, I will press Escape to exit from the measurement mode, and then click on the Return to 3D Mode button. I will hit Escape again. Since I want to use a shell model instead of solid, I will suppress and hide the solid part. I will unhide the volume part and specify the boundary conditions. This section is the inlet, so I will select it, navigate to Groups, click Create Name Selection, and name it Inlet. Similarly, I will define the outlet and name it Outlet. I also need to name the walls. First, I will select the thinner walls, create a name selection, and name it Wall 0.75 millimeters. Next, I will select these two thicker plates and name them Wall 1.5 millimeters. Everything is correct. Since this is a single volume part, there is no need to use shared topology. Now, I will close the geometry setup and move on to meshing. I will double-click on mesh. My CPU has 8 processors. I will check the double precision box and hit start. The first step is importing the geometry. I will navigate to Geometry and click Import Geometry. The geometry has been imported successfully. Since I don't need any local sizing, I will click Update. Next, I will specify the minimum and maximum element sizes. Set the minimum size to 0.4 millimeters and set the maximum element size to 4 millimeters. I will keep the default settings and click Generate Surface Mesh. The surface mesh has been generated successfully. Since we only have a fluid domain, I will select the geometry consisting only of fluid regions with no voids. I won't change any options and will proceed by clicking Describe Geometry. The inlet is defined as a velocity inlet. The outlet is defined as a pressure outlet because the fluid drains into the environment. The walls are set as walls. Finally, I will click Update Boundaries. The volume is set to fluid, so I will click Update Regions. Now, I will add boundary layers by clicking Add Boundary Layers. Three layers will be generated. In the Generate Volume Mesh step, I will change the polyhedral mesh type to polyhex core and click Generate Volume Mesh. The volume mesh has been created successfully. The mesh quality is 0.4, which is very high. Everything looks correct. Let's check the number of cells. It's about 87,000. If we don't suppress the solid part, the cell count increases to over 210,000. Now, I will close this window. I will double-click on the setup cell to prepare the model, then click Start. I won't change the time option because I want to perform the simulation in steady state. To add a material, I will expand Materials, locate Fluid, and double-click on Air. Since the density of air changes with temperature, I will modify the density setting from constant to ideal gas and click Change. Now, I will close the window. We will leave the solid material unchanged for now, as I plan to add copper later. I will navigate to Boundary Conditions, expand the list, and select Inlet. The inlet velocity is set to 5 meters per second, and the inlet temperature is 150 Celsius. However, since the default unit is Kelvin, I need to change it to Celsius. I will click Apply and close the window. To adjust the temperature units, I will navigate to Units, select Temperature, change Kelvin to Celsius, and then close the window. Now, I will reopen the inlet boundary, set the temperature to 150 Celsius, click Apply, and close it. For the outlet, I need to adjust the pressure outlet settings. I will double-click on Outlet, enable Prevent Reverse Flow, click Apply, and then close the window. I want to use the shell conduction model instead of the solid part of the body. This approach reduces the number of computational cells. Now, let's define it for the wall. I will expand the wall section in boundary conditions. There are two walls, as I named them earlier. I will double-click on the thinner wall. In the thermal section, we can specify heat transfer properties. Let's start with convection. Here, we can specify the heat transfer coefficient and temperature, but convection alone only allows heat transfer in the radial direction, which would lead to incorrect results. To ensure proper heat transfer through the wall, we need to use the shell conduction model. This allows heat to transfer in all directions, not just radially, providing a more accurate representation of thermal behavior through the wall. I will simply check the shell conduction box to enable it and hit Edit button. In this window, we need to specify the material and thickness. The material is copper, so let's add it. I will close this window and go to Materials. Then, I will right-click on Aluminum and select Edit. In the Fluid Database, I will change the material type to Solid, select Copper, and click Copy. Finally, I will close the window. Now, there are two materials available, copper and aluminum. Let's navigate back to walls. Check the Shell Conduction box again and click Edit. We must specify the thickness of the solid part, which is 0.75 millimeters. Moreover, I will change the material from aluminum to copper and click on OK. Since there is no heat flux because the walls are exposed to convection, I need to change the heat flux setting to convection. I will set the temperature to 22 Celsius and enter 5 for the heat transfer coefficient. Finally, I will click Apply. Everything is correct, so I will close the window. Now, let's adjust the thicker wall. I will double-click on it and navigate to the thermal section. I will change the heat flux to convection and check the Shell Conduction box. The heat transfer coefficient is 5 and the temperature is 22 Celsius. Next, I will click Edit, enter 1.5 millimeters for the thickness, and change the material to copper. After that, I will click OK. Finally, I will click Apply and close the window. Everything is correct. In this step, we must prepare the model for computation. I will navigate to Initialization, change Hybrid Initialization to Standard, select the inlet, and click Initialize. Next, I will go to Run Calculation, enter 200 for the number of iterations, and finally, click Calculate. Now, I will wait for the simulation to complete. Once the solution is finished, I will click OK to close the information box. Now, I want to create temperature contours. I will navigate to Results, expand Graphics, right-click on Contour, and select New. I will select the walls and change the contour type from pressure to temperature. Finally, I will click Save and Display. As you can see, the temperature distribution on the walls is now visible. I recommend renaming the contour to temperature and clicking Save. Next, let's investigate the velocity field. I will right-click on Contour, select New, and rename it to Velocity. Then, I will change the contour type from temperature to velocity. We need to create a plane to visualize the velocity profile in the middle of the geometry. I will click New Surface, choose Plane, select XY Plane in the method, and click Create. A new plane has been created. Now, I will select the plane, click Save and Display, and examine the velocity distribution inside the geometry. Let's investigate the heat transfer balance. I will close this window and navigate to the Results tab. In this section, we can find fluxes reports. Under the options, I'm going to select Total Heat Transfer Rate and choose Inlet, then click Compute. As you can see, the inlet power is approximately 360 watts. Next, in the same report, I will select the walls and outlet. Then click Compute again. All heat power values have now been displayed. We can clearly see the inlet heat, the outlet heat, and the heat loss through the walls due to convection. The net result is around minus 1.5 watts. This small imbalance occurs because the solution hasn't fully converged. To improve accuracy, we need to reduce the residual scale, and the imbalance will approach zero. I'd also like to enable radiation heat transfer. To do this, I will close the flux reports, navigate to boundary conditions, and double-click on wall. In the thermal section, I'm going to change convection to mixed, which enables both convection and radiation. Now, we need to specify the external emissivity. I'll enter 0.4 and set the external temperature to 22 Celsius. We need to repeat the same steps for the thicker wall. I'll close the window and double-click on wall 1.5 millimeters to continue. I'll go to the thermal section, change convection to mixed, set the thermal emissivity to 0.4, and update the external temperature to 22 Celsius. After making these changes, I will click Apply and solve the simulation again. Once the solution is complete, let's check the flux reports again. I'll click on Fluxes and then hit Compute. I have to choose total heat transfer rate. As you can see, the power values of each section are displayed. The net heat transfer is about minus 1.8 watts, and to improve the energy balance, we need to further reduce the residuals to bring the imbalance closer to zero. Let's compare the results of convection only and mixed heat transfer. Adding radiation increases the total heat transfer by approximately 30 watts. Thanks for watching. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more content like this.